for the crowd we've got today here. Well, to all of you and those on Zoom, please stand and join in singing our opening hymn, Sing to the Mountains, Sing to the Sea.
Thank you. us, O Lord, to trust in you with all our hearts. For as you always resist the proud, rely on your own strength, so you never forsake those who make their boast of your mercy. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Prayer of our search committee. Almighty God, you know the needs of your church in every place. Look graciously upon the people of Emmanuel Church and grant the search committee the guidance of your Holy Spirit as they seek a new rector for this parish. Grant them discernment, wisdom, and guidance as they listen for your voice. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
The first lesson is from Philemon. Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, and Timothy, our brother. To Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God, because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith towards the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do in Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me, so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I preferred to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother. Especially to me, but now, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way, or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me, even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ, confident of your obedience and writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm will be read responsibly by a whole verse. I will begin. Lord, you have searched me out and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar.
You trace my dreams and my restless places, and are acquainted with all my ways.
Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it altogether.
Rest on me, mind and forward, and pray in your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful. It is so high that I cannot attain to it.
You yourself created my inmost parts, beginning together in my mother's womb.
I will thank you because I am marvelously made. Your works are wonderful, and I know it well.
Our body was not hidden from me, while I was being made in secret,
and woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb. All of them were written in your book, and were fashioned day by day, when as yet there was none of them.
If I find your thoughts, O God, I pray to some of them.
If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand. To count them all, my lifespan would need to be like yours.
And he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost, to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able, with 10,000, to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then, while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
The epistle lesson this morning is actually one of my favorite books of the Bible. One of the reasons is that, unlike any of the other books of Scripture, the letter to Philemon is not a public document. Paul's letter to Philemon is a private note about a private matter. In short, it is not meant to be read by anyone other than its recipient. Its power comes not from Paul's theology, but from that theology in action, in one personal request that Paul makes of his friend, Philemon. You see, Philemon is the leader of the Christian church in the city of Colossae. He's a wealthy man who owns slaves, or we know it, he owned at least one enslaved person named Onesimus. Now, we don't know the whole story, but it seems that at some point that the enslaved Onesimus escapes from Philemon and finds his way to Paul, who is in Rome. Somewhere along the line, Onesimus becomes a Christian, becomes a faithful companion and servant to Paul. But then Paul is sent to prison in Rome. While in prison, Paul continues writing to all the churches he founded around the empire, including Colossae. He realizes that as long as Onesimus, the former enslaved man, remains unreconciled to Philemon, he will always live in fear and uncertainty. And Paul tries to rectify this. So he writes two letters. One is a public letter to the Christians in Colossae, what we know as the letter to the Colossians, a letter which is meant to be read aloud in church. He also writes a private note to Philemon concerning Onesimus. He sends both letters to Colossae by way of his friend Tychicus, and also sends along Onesimus to accompany Tychicus. In fact, in the public letter to Colossians, Paul writes, "Tychicus will tell you all the news about me. He is coming with Onesimus, the faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. They will tell you about everything here." Little newsy letter to the community about the two messengers who will say more about what's going on. But in the second letter, the private letter to Philemon, Paul says what we hear today. He tells Philemon that Onesimus is now a Christian, and as such is now a brother to him. Paul hints that he wants Philemon to free Onesimus from slavery, but he will not command him to do so. He wants Philemon to act freely out of love and forgiveness to Onesimus for running away and be reconciled to him. As he writes, Paul writes, "I wanted to keep Onesimus with me, but I preferred to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced." The good deed that he must do is free Onesimus. It was actually quite a shocking request because it turns the standard social systems upside down. It was like when Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation, freeing the enslaved people during the American Civil War. In fact, the cover of our bulletin is an abolitionist poster from that time. And the original picture actually had the words underneath it where the enslaved man is saying, "Am I not a man and a brother?" Which is exactly what Paul is saying to Philemon. But at this time, slavery is seen as normal, necessary part of the economy and social structure. And suddenly Paul is suggesting that under Christ, slavery is no longer appropriate. In Colossians, the other letter that he sent along, the two letters, so Colossians, Paul writes saying that the reign of God, the reign of Jesus, is a place of forgiveness, and that baptism is a place of entrance into this reign of God. And one of the most powerful statements that Paul says in his letter to the Colossians, and of course Philemon is listening to this too, is when Paul writes about baptism, saying, "In that renewal, there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave and free, but Christ is all in all." We're baptized into the body of Christ. All those old distinctions, all those old hierarchies, all those old ways we used to separate and condemn each other no longer count. In baptism, we are all equal. We can no longer claim to be master over another. I'm sure this point was not lost on Philemon. How can he claim to be a Christian and keep another Christian as his slave? Paul is outlining his theological point about baptism, all while knowing that Philemon is wrestling with this very issue regarding Onesimus. Baptism is a place of transformation. Christ's body is the place where we start to experience the reign of God in this world. This reign is a place of freedom from slavery, the slavery of sin and dominance. It's a place of radical inclusiveness where the hierarchies we accept as normal in this world no longer carry weight. The letter to the Colossians and the letter to Philemon each informs the other. When it's public, it gives the theory. When it's private, gives the shocking example of what the theory looks like in real life. The theology of Colossians is about being baptized into a new life of freedom. The real life example is about literally freeing the enslaved Onesimus. To whom are we enslaved? What roles or conditions have been imposed on us which tell us that we are less than we really are? Just a plumber or a stay-at-home mom and therefore considered incapable, sophisticated, and meaningful opinions? Are women considered less intelligent or competent than men? Are you considered hopeless because of addictions? Are you discriminated against because you are gay or lesbian? Are you discounted because you were the youngest child, the problem child, or didn't meet your family's expectations? In what ways are we held back? By societies, or our families, roles, and hierarchies? Conversely, who do we treat as enslaved or as less than we are? Be fearful of immigrants and those who don't speak English as a first language. Are we more likely to discount as unintelligent those who have a different political view than ourselves? Do we like to be bossy at work to our subordinates? Do we perceive those who are wealthy as better or worse than those who are not? Do we treat our children as merely extensions of ourselves? What roles or hierarchies do we create or perpetuate? The kicker is that by doing so, we are doing ourselves a disservice. Because it's not only Onesimus who is freed from slavery, but his owner, Philemon. By setting Onesimus free from slavery, Philemon is engaging in kingdom building, freeing himself from worldly distinctions that enslave him in the soul-sucking role of master. Freeing the slave from slavery frees the master. He gains a brother to boot. When we both let go of diminishing others as well as refusing to accept the diminishment of ourselves imposed by others, we become truly free. Of course, the reign of God is not yet fully realized. But through baptism, all of us are vowing to be part of this transformation. To gain freedom from slavery, given and imposed. To strive for love and reconciliation. So that, as Paul says, Christ is all and in all. Stand and declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, the Father.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Please be healed for the prayers of the church.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. Strengthen our resolve to counter the sin of racism. Eliminate the proliferation of assault weapons, and address the crisis of loneliness and mental illness in our nation. Heal all nations suffering from war and natural disaster. We especially lift up the people of Ukraine and Russia, that peace may be restored. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. We pray especially for those suffering from COVID, their loved ones, and healthcare professionals. In our parish family, we pray for Amy, Arthur, Debbie Beth, Janet Villa, Una, Doris Butler, Lydia Syndrome, Eva Chase, Cheryl, Robert Cobell, Dan, Dorothy, Doug, Peggy Elkins, Rich Farrell, David Fieldhouse, the Hallwell and Armstrong family, JC, JD, JW, Jeanette, Jeffrey, Scott Johnson, Julia, Deborah Catloy, LW, Kevin McKenzie, Sandy McGee, Molly Manmore, Kathy McGowan, Michael, Becky Miller, Jim Murphy, Vicki Oman, Joseph Oliveri, Jim O'Reilly, Cheryl Pappas, Lisa Pappas, Owen Coleman, John Robillard, Brian Smith, Jamie Susan family, Walter Thorpe, Bill and Jan Walsh, Vicki Whiteweiser, and Carl Webster. Today we remember Mary McIntosh Gates, Bishop Gates' mother, who died this week. We also give thanks for Edith and Leonard Phillips, Norma and Paul Fisella, Marion Santoro, and David Santoro, whose memory the altar flowers are given. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will. Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness to each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in the love to serve only your will. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins.
into the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you. Please have a seat. Again, good morning. Good to see everyone. Just a reminder, this is our last 9 a.m. summer service that's starting next Sunday, September 11th. We'll be moving to our traditional 8 and 10. So, right 1, 8 o'clock service, right 2, 10 o'clock service next Sunday. So, just be aware of the time change. It's all you also our annual cookout after the 10 o'clock service. So if you are an 8 o'clock, we hope maybe you could return in time, you know, 11:15 and join us for the cookout. Please bring a salad, side, drinks, or dessert to share. The sign-up sheet will be circulated this week via email. So your eyes open for that. Bible study will meet during my last two Sundays. For those of you who haven't heard, I will be leaving the end of September. So my last two Sundays will be September 18th and 25th. We will have a Bible study between the services on those 2 days. All of us have been seeing the terrible news about the floods in Pakistan. If you'd like to do something to help, I encourage you to be in touch with the Episcopal Relief and Development, ERD. And they will be supporting people in Pakistan during the floods. Are there other announcements to make?
Hello, everybody. I have a couple of announcements. One is that Sacred Ground will begin on Zoom a week from Monday night. It's not too late. We'd love to have some more people join us. So just reach out to me if you're interested. It starts in person this week at the Church of the Good Shepherd on September 7th. So you have two choices. You could either do it in person or do it on Zoom. I'm leading the Zoom, and Brian, who's the rector, Reverend Brian Grace, is leading the in-person. We are having a confirmation class next week, as it's been published and announced. It will be immediately after our cookout. We are having a little bit of struggle going forward, knowing what to do, because Bishop Gale has postponed her visit to us, which was supposed to be November 13th. She was going to come and do a visitation and do confirmation, but she's postponed it till April. So in the meantime, we will be looking for alternatives. But the first step is to gather the kids together and to try to form some community among them as we go. Thank you. Carl.
Good morning. I had another operation on the weeks of
wonderful, great news, Carl. Thank you. Do we have coffee hour today? Lemonade and lemon? I'm not sure. I don't think anyone signed up for it, but please do join the Gather for Fellowship. And that does lead us into we are looking for people to host lemonade or coffee hour going forward. So please do be in touch with Chrissy Hoeg or the office. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to us.
Thank you.
things come of thee, O Lord. May God be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let's give thanks to our Creator.
We give Almighty thanks and praise.
Holy God, lover of creation, we give you thanks and praise for the ocean of your steadfast love. You bear us and place the song of your Spirit in our hearts. When we turn from your love and defile the earth, you do not abandon us. Your Spirit speaks through Huldah and Micah, prophets, sages, and saints in every age, to confront our sin and reveal the vision of your new creation. Joining in the song of the universe, we proclaim your glory, singing,
thank you.
them in remembrance that Christ lived, died, and rose again for you. You know him in your hearts by faith.
Thank you.